Good evening, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to a very special Florida Conversations. You know, it's not often that we have a dance floor and hors d'oeuvres at our lectures, so you know this is going to be a special evening. I'm C.J. Roberts, the Frankie Duckwell President and CEO of the Tampa Bay History Center. This year, we're celebrating the unique relationship and shared history between Cuba and Florida. From our award-winning Cuban Pathways exhibit, which will travel to other parts of the state, we're very excited about that when it closes here in January, to Cuban sandwiches, to literature, we've offered our guests and our members a taste of this special connection. Tonight's program continues with the exploration of Cuban music and dance. And I'd like to thank Richard Gonzmart and the Gonzmart family for participating, for providing the Cuban cuisine that you all enjoyed on the way in, and for sharing the flamenco dance troupe. And also, Richard, thank you for a great, almost now 14-year partnership with the cafe here. It's really been terrific. I'd also like to thank our program partners, the University of South Florida Libraries, WSF Public Media, and AARP Florida. Finally, a big thank you to Maruchi Azorín. Anyone who knows her knows that she has a passion for the history and culture of Cuba and has worked tirelessly to share this rich history with the community. As a Tampa Bay History Center trustee, Maruchi has been a full partner in helping us develop our Cuban Pathways exhibit, our award-winning Cuban Pathways exhibit, which she and her husband, Rafael, also generously sponsored. She's also helped us organize a number of other programs, including tonight's event. Her counsel over the years, as we've worked to ensure we're welcoming and telling stories to as broad and diverse a community as possible, has been invaluable, particularly to me. And Maruchi, we're just very grateful to you. So thank you. And with that, I'm going to turn the program over to you.
Sitting up here. And how exciting is that?
Is this working? All right, thank you. Thank you for joining us tonight to celebrate Cuban Pathways in a different fashion. Secondarily, thank you to the Gonzmarts for doing this for us. They are treasures in our community, as we all know, and we look forward to hearing the stories that Richard will share and that Andrea will also probably put a couple of little words in for us. And then, of course, don't go away after we finish conversing, because Maria Aurora is going to be dancing with her three, and we can't say flamenco because she has a big surprise for you. It's a brand new dance, costumes, and choreography. So, yeah, that's going to be really neat. So, thank you, CJ, for that very kind introduction. Welcome to the Tampa Bay History Center. Richard Gonzmart is one of Tampa's treasures and the patriarch of the Gonzmart family, and I welcome him to the stage. Come on up. We are thrilled, absolutely thrilled that you're doing this for us. And you and I have spoken about this before, because we both love music. We adored your mother. And so why don't we just start right there? What is your earliest memory of Cuban music and your mother?
I guess my earliest memories in life is music and my mother. My parents met in Cuba when my dad was a concertmaster violinist for the Ernesto Lecuona Orchestra. My mom was a graduate Juilliard going to perform, and that's where they met, or I wouldn't be here. But the earliest memories, I was 3 years old. And Ernesto Lecuona was a very dear friend of my mother and father. And he would come into the house, and I told my mother, "Mama, I want to perform for Señor Lecuona. You want to perform?" "Yes, I want to play my violin." And so there's a picture of me playing this little violin with my little green shorts and moccasins, and my mom playing the piano and smiling. And I really, truly thought I was playing the violin. And Mr. Lecuona was very kind and said, "That was very nice. I hope to see you next year."
One of the things that maybe our guests do know who Ernesto Lecuona is, Ernesto Lecuona is the most prolific Hispanic composer ever. The man composed over 1,000 pieces of music, ranging from operettas to songs that we all know, Malagueña, Andalucía, which is named in English, The Breeze and I. And a lot of people don't realize that he was nominated for an Academy Award for music.
You know, he did so much, and it was the music my mother loved, and she was a concert pianist, and he would play his music. And did you know he wrote a song called Viva Ybor? And on the cover of the music was my father playing a conga drum. How did we find that? I don't know.
You've got it.
But did you know that the Columbia actually opened on December 31st, 1958? We had been in Cuba for 6 weeks. My grandfather buying the beautiful tiles from Cuba that adorned the Siboney. The Siboney is named after Ernesto's song. December 31st, 1958, we weren't ready. There was no stage. They just put a stand. These beautiful murals painted by a famous Cuban artist named Tio Carrasco were being painted on the walls. Nothing was done, but the beautiful mural of the Siboney Indians who were slaughtered by the conquistadors, peaceful. And my grandfather said he was the last of the Siboney. But that night, Ernesto Lecuona opened up the Siboney, and he performed for 3 months. So people were leaving Ybor City because this thing called urban renewal that's going to improve your city moved all the people out to the suburbs. With that, every business closed, every of the markets. The cigar factories disappeared, all 188 except the Cuesta Rey. So when I think of that, that the courage my grandfather trusted my father to open a dining room where they actually had a little door to bring in cable for Channel 8, WFLA would broadcast shows there. TV must have been pretty boring back then. But I can remember seeing them at the studio playing, but they would bring in the best performers of all of Cuba. The Tropicana had an outdoor lounge where they would do the dancing. 1961, my dad had opened a restaurant called Rocky Point Inn, where he recreated that. What I remember being in Cuba when they took me to that outdoor lounge were the beautiful costumes and flowers and the beautiful women that were dancing. But it really is. It's just that culture, that music when I hear it, and I can't wait to see. And there's one song that's been my favorite, and I just can never remember the name. I talked to some people today from Oregon that were from Cuba. They said they heard me speaking Spanish. Are you from Cuba? I said, yeah, I'm Cuban. Yes, my family came from Cuba in 1898, 97 or so. But I'm really, really proud of that culture. I'm proud of the Spanish culture on my dad's side. That flamenco, the dance of the Ernesto Lecuona. But I will share something that with the day that my mom passed away on December 22nd at home under hospice care, I knew her love for Ernesto Lecuona. And I just had the music playing from all of his CDs. I went and found all that I could do is to play. That Ernesto would welcome her with my dad. I didn't know any other way to really tell my mom how much I loved her. But to be surrounded by that music, that's who she was, a loving and caring parent.
Thank you. That was amazing. Thank you so much. We have a surprise. I'm not sure you might know. There's a video that someone has compiled with some unbelievable photographs of the Siboney room, your mom, your dad, the performances. So, Billy, here's your cue.
There we go.
Anoche te soñé y en mi delirio mi vida te entregué en un suspiro. Me hablaste, te escuché.
That's me.
Y nunca dije, temblando te besé. Dulce amorcito, llegó la realidad y mi
alegría. Andrea Gonzmart, my daughter, performing the evening.
Tan solo se volvió melancolía. Anoche yo soñé que ansiosa te tenía. Y cuando vino el día, muy solo me encontré.
Thank you. Wonderful.
I wish I could have commented on each one of those photos. And in Cuba, there was there was the violins at Pepe Curais that was in Cuba, and wonderful violins. And when I visited them in 1958 when we were there. And when Castro came, he left, and they came to Tampa. I went to school with two of his sons, and then they went to Miami and opened Los Violines down there, and were successful. See, look at all those pictures. There was a gentleman playing bongos, he was my barber as well. His grandson was Eric Armirola. He's a NASCAR racer. You look at all these people, and there's a pianist that was there that played for the Columbia for 61 years, or 64. Guinness World Book of Records for the longest gig. So I saw all those pictures, and I hadn't seen some of those. But music has been in my life. My daughter plays the piano. My mom gave her her favorite piano. And what I'm really proud of is we found her 1921 Steinway that had been discarded. She had two pianos, a ballroom that she liked. I called Steinway. I said, I have this piano. They pick it up. I said, well, what do you want us to do with this piano? It's old. I said, I want you to restore it. You could buy a new one. What do you want me to do? Throw my mother's piano away. For 11 months, they restored it to the original. They had the original colors. They gave me the original price that they paid. You can't get rid of that. Now we're building a restaurant in Lombok Key called The Buccaneer, my mom and dad's favorite restaurant. That piano will be there. Her spirit will live on.
Most definitely, most definitely. Speaking of your daughter, would you like to introduce her? She's with us in the audience. Want to introduce your daughter? She's with us in the audience.
My youngest daughter, Andrea Gonzmart, she looks a lot like my mom. She's talented like my mom, and she's a musician. And what's even better, she's a great cook like my mom. And if you're watching TV on Tuesday, what's the name of that show?
Kelly and Ryan.
Kelly and Ryan. She's going to be live cooking and teaching them how to cook.
This Tuesday morning.
Yeah, like New York on Monday.
How awesome. That is
wonderful. I'm afraid
she's
going to end up being a television star.
I still never forget him when I'm famous.
She does resemble your mother so much, but and her mannerisms.
I just have to say why we're here today. I saw Tom Touchton, and I remember at Harbor Island, we had a Columbia restaurant there. And on the second floor, they were doing a fundraiser for a history center. And my dad said, you have to come up there. Do what? What are you talking about? History's so important, we have to preserve it. You have to promise me, if I'm not here, that you'll do this. I said, I will. And I believed in Mr. Touchdown. I believed in that dream. And everybody thought we were crazy. Look what's happened around us. I think, Tom, you made me look smart.
Absolutely. All of those memories, you and I have spoken recently about before the flamenco dancing started. You used to really play Cuban dancing and Cuban music, correct? When did the flamenco begin?
You know, I want to say the flamenco, Ybor City, urban renewal, everybody moved out, all the businesses closed. We had to try to attract tourists because locals were afraid to go there. So we had to bring in the flamenco too. We'd gone to Spain as a guest. My dad was invited by Generalissimo Franco, being honored for what we did. And he came back with this idea. We went to La Alhambra, all the beautiful towels. That's where the idea came from. And we brought in the best dancers. There was a gentleman named Jose Greco. Very good friends of our family. And so when in the 50s he came, and he came and performed over three different times. And he was just, you know, I just know all these people as just regular people. He was a wonderful guy. He had a wonderful gentleman, a young man that played under him. He was even a better dancer, Carlos Molina, that I traveled Spain with him for Canada for 2 weeks in the month of February promoting Florida. Him dancing and me cooking paella. But you think about those, and then we had the great guitarist Sabicas. I went to Spain when I was married in 73 for 1 year, and I studied under the greatest flamenco guitarist at the time for 1 year, and don't ask me to play that. Don't ask me to play the piano or violin, but I play some good 1960 rock and roll.
Without a doubt. Also,
did I answer the question?
It doesn't matter. It was wonderful. Please tell us more. I saw Liberace.
Listen, Liberace, you see these people and everybody. I remember seeing Liberace all the time. My dad would play. He was touring the United States. His name is actually Cesar Gonzalez Martinez. Cesar Gonzalez, that's my dad. That's my dad. I'm sorry, not Liberace. But Cesar Gonzalez Martinez is like John Smith Jones. So he combined his father's name, Gonzalez and Martinez, together. And so they would travel throughout the United States, and often they would play in the same place at the St. Louis. I can't remember the name of the hotel. There's a picture of my brother in a walker. He's like 10 months old. Liberace had his sister, and they're cooking food on a hot plate, and my brother going out to eat the food. But when Liberace would come to town, he was such a nice man. But when you shake hands with him, his rings were so thick. You know, you see all these people and all these famous people that you know, but my father knew. And there's a beautiful portrait of my mom and dad that an artist here, Arnold Martinez, did of coffee and red wine. And I call it their Lucy and Desi because they truly were artists. And my mom was a beautiful woman, but what she was a truly loving, caring person. And so I see that every time I go by. I was diagnosed at the age of 45 with ADD and dyslexia, so you have to pardon me. My brain's a roulette. If you walk with me in the Columbia restaurant, you can enter my brain. When I go by certain tables or certain memories, I can tell you who sat at those tables where Liza Minnelli and Joel Gray sat at table 52. They happened to be there on my 40th birthday. I can show you where Sonny Bono was and table 21. I can show you where Joe DiMaggio sat with Marilyn Monroe in 52. I wasn't born, but I know the story. Where Ian Fleming. So I could just tell you all these things, all these great performers. When you're raised around that, you know, you're an entertainer, and I guess I'm an entertainer. I still do play with a band now. I told my wife that I'm going to retire, and I'm going on tour. She said, you better get some extra credit cards.
What? Go ahead. You have a story.
Huh?
Go ahead. I feel there's a story coming.
No, there's always stories. We'll be here till tomorrow.
You'd have to find a new home, too.
If you don't know, we bought a home about 18 years ago, and I built a room to play the guitar. My mom and dad loved listening to me to play. And 30 minutes later, my wife says, how long is that racket going to continue? I took a guitar to my office the next day. And about a year ago, she walks into my office, and she looks, Richard, you have a serious problem. I have 140 guitars in my office. I have a drum set. I have conga drums. I have keyboards. I have 7 amplifiers, 8 amplifiers. I soundproof the room. They tell me it's not soundproof enough. But you know, it's when I see it, it's artwork. You know, many of them autographed by artists that people look up to, and I do. But when I see it, I hear my dad. And my dad always thought he would be forgotten. When you go into the Columbia, if you're seeing me and you hear me stop talking, it's because my dad's playing the violin. And I'm thinking of him. If you didn't know that song, that was my dad singing.
I was wondering if that you have mentioned to
me
that your father.
He didn't know. So it's when I'm walking through there, I said he'll never be forgotten. And I created a bottle of wine named after him when he was still alive. And he's in Tampa Journal, pancreatic cancer. He's autographing to the nurses. And Leroy Neiman, the famous artist, did a sketch of him, gave me permission to use it. You know, history, Mr. Touchton, history can never be forgotten. History always has to be remembered, the good and the bad. And we should learn from the bad so it becomes good. And that's the way I feel. So when I'm there, that I'm wearing my dad's cologne, that when he passed away, it's the last of my bottle. I'm wearing it today to be with you. And that this wire bear my mother gave me that belonged to my grandfather. They're the history they gave me. I'm just Richard. I was born to a family that loved me and family that cares. My daughter's the same way. I'm nobody different. I wear blue jeans to work, and my dad would really send me home. But I just want to know that everybody, I think the most important job in my restaurant is washing dishes. And that's, my dad didn't want me to do that. And that's where I worked at 12. Still my most fun. That's, I think, where I learned the most about life and about being a dishwasher. And I make everybody sure to respect that. So I'm just a simple person. Honest to God, I'm nobody. I'm going to be a blip on the radar. But I just hope, and I know, that she'll carry on. This is about a community that supports one another. And when I faced challenges in 95, I prayed to God to give me the courage and strength and wisdom, and that's what I do, is to help others. I'm visiting all my units, all my restaurants, talking to them. I want to help them realize their dreams. What do you want to do? My mom started the Latino Scholarship Program 32 years ago, and I said, what are you doing? And they gave it to a young lady at the Columbia. That young lady's a medical doctor at UCLA today. So afterwards, when I went through, I created an endowment in honor of my 100th anniversary, and then my parents and my wife and I. We have 32 students today under full scholarship. Money is to be used wisely, and the young man that my mother said when I didn't have the money to do it, so you're going to do Julio Rodriguez, I'm going to do his sister. Their father was a migrant worker that died. And Julio graduated 4.0 in engineering. Elsie, the top senior out of 5,700 students. She went on to New Mexico Nuclear Energy. Julio, GE Aeronautical. Today, they have their own scholarship. Today, they have a restaurant honoring their mother. Don Julio's out in Temple Palms. Young man graduated from Indiana University as a doctor. There's some in doctors. When I look at these people, but what struck me most is when Julio came back that December to visit his mother after graduating. He said, Mr. Gonzmart, when I was in Brandon High School, I'd look out the window wondering where I'd be picking strawberries or picking tomatoes. This country's a great country of immigrants, people that struggled like the Cubans, like Maruchi's family that lost everything and came back and worked hard. Like my family, who had nothing, no education. And each family faced those challenges. It's what you do when you are challenged. And like my grandfather during the Great Prohibition, that he would give food along with the Moray family and the Guajardo family with no expectation. When we closed for COVID, we did the equivalent of 9,000 meals a week for our employees, 4 meals a week. Because that's what family businesses do, and that's what this United States of America should do, is help one another. I'm here to. I'm not running for office. But listen. I'm here talking to you. The music of Cuba, and I will not go back to Cuba until it's free. I've been invited to go back. I will not go back. I will not support that. Because you have these people that are building their little businesses, and the government understands it, and they're taking it away from them. You have physicians making hardly any money. So I guess I can become political, but I see the day that Cuba is libre once again, and I hope to pray to God to be there, and I'll open a Colombian restaurant.
Absolutely. In Camagüey and La Habana, both. We're really open, Richard. We're open to questions, if you don't mind.
I'm brutally honest. When you tell the truth, you don't have a good memory. I'm really, really, really honest about anything, and I'll answer anything to the best of my ability. When I say that, nobody ever asked me a question.
I have a question.
Yes.
Where's the name Columbia?
Columbia comes from the name of the Columbia Gem in the Ocean. It was a song that the ship that navigated the Earth, first American ship, 1827. It was the Columbia Gem of the Ocean. It almost became our national anthem, the District of Columbia. The United States was almost Columbia. It's not where the O. We don't serve Colombian food. So, but people don't know. My grandfather was so proud to come to this country and leave Cuba because of the problems then that he opened it as a manager of the Florida Brewery. They opened the Columbia Saloon on December 17, 1903. I realized I missed the 100th anniversary in 2004. Gary Mormino says, we have a problem. You are the oldest restaurant. What's the problem? You have to change the name of the salad. So here's the secret. If you don't like tomatoes, order the 1903 salad. And everybody knows that, because some people don't like it. I can't start changing history. But in 1905, he did buy it, and the Columbia was open 24 hours a day for the men walking to and from work. And what happened, too, is... During the Great Depression, my grandfather with a handshake borrowed $30,000 to build the first air-conditioned dining room. 1935, my mother tells me she heard her father tell her mother that if it didn't work, he'd have to blow his brains out. He was trying to build a business so where men could take their wives to dance, because back then women didn't do it. There's a picture of my dad standing up on the mezzanine at 16 years old, and they took that out to build a real band shell in 1939. On December 7th, 2001, I asked my mom permission to be able to restore it. That's the last time I ever talked to my mother. I wouldn't have done it without her, so I've gone back. On December 7th, I left for Tucson, Arizona, to run a marathon on December 9th, anniversary of my dad's death. And during the marathon, it was 6 miles of hills and 19 down, and my mother had arthritis, and I was suffering. I'm thinking about my mom. I should be thinking about my mom. Thinking about my mom. And when I finished, my wife says, during the marathon, your brother called, your mother just had a massive stroke. I said, I'm a person of great faith. My mother was with me. She was with me. She's with me today. My daddy's with me today. I wake up early because I feel him with me. But I wouldn't do anything that would never honor my parents' wishes. My mom says my wife says I have to stop trying to fulfill their wishes. I've done everything. And so at the night, December 9th, she doesn't believe me, 2025, I step away from the daily activity. I'm not going to retire.
Oh, well, you've changed your verbiage now.
No. I'm not going to do the day-to-day. I'm going to work with children. I work with AMI kids. I'm going to work with kids to help them realize hope. I keep my transcripts from Jesuit High School on my desk. I was 116 out of 126 in my class, and they made my grades better. I was recruited to play football for 30 schools, so they made the grades better. They didn't know how to teach a person like me, but when I realized I'm not stupid, I just think different. I am a gifted individual. I just got to surround myself with people that can keep me straight. Yes, sir. You know, my father's father made the box, and his father would be the selector of the outer leaf for Perfecto Garcia. I don't smoke as much. I smoke only local cigars, Arturo Fuente. I like the Don Carlos Robusto if I'm smoking. My doctor says, my cardiologist says I can't smoke. Then I find out he smokes every day. I said, there's something wrong here. My great-grandfather, my dad's father, lived to be 89 and smoked a cigar from 8 in the morning till 7 o'clock, and I always wonder why I smelled weird. And everything was cooked in lard, and I found a state where lard is good. He lived to be 89 years old. He died falling out of a peach tree, broke his hips, and had complications with pneumonia. I pray to God I've got those genes. So, you know, I think I'm going to smoke a cigar tomorrow. Every morning at 7, I'm going to have one.
Any other questions from our audience here? Yes, please.
You confused me when you started out and said you opened the restaurant in 1958.
The Siboney.
Siboney. Yeah, he. Listen, you gotta. It's tough to follow my conversations. My wife says, "In what restaurant are you talking about now?" The Siboney was the last dream built by my dad. It was the old Wholesome Bakery, and they built it there. But they had a makeshift bandstand. And there was a building beyond it. And my dad and my mom couldn't convince my grandfather to build it. My grandmother, Carmen Piloto Hernandez, gave my father the money to build it and expand it. So we go to the end. So the last table's on 7th Avenue, 21st Street. The kitchen, the dishwasher's on 22nd Street, 6th Avenue. And when you asked your waiter for an extra piece of lemon, they usually didn't smile. The kitchen is now located 6,000 square feet in the middle. But I'm sorry. There's 15 dining rooms in the Columbia restaurant now. It's 52,000 square feet. And we have another dining room. We have a museum across the street we do for functions. And I'm really, really, really passionate. Everything basically is cooked to order. I import a container from Spain every 4 to 6 weeks. I import my rice from Murcia, La Bomba. I import my olive oil from a family in high-end. It's 19 years ago. I import my vinegar from, I import everything. I love doing business here. It's a handshake. That's the way this country was. My grandfather says, your handshake's more powerful than any contract. I do stuff with Sicily. I love doing business. And when I go there, I feel like I'm back in the 20s or 30s. I went to Madrid, Spain to a store on my birthday for a weekend. A friend of mine, Andy Lubrano, had passed away. He was in my band. I told my wife, let's go for a long weekend. What do you mean a long weekend? So we go into the store. They have ceramics. And a gentleman about 80 years old says in Spanish to me, where are you from? I said, Florida. I have a very good friend in Florida. Do you know Cesar Gonzmart? Please. Yes, I do. So his son is a year older than me. We're best friends. And so I'm getting the sangria pictures from a family in Talavera, and we get them directly. Then I go to an antique store, Sandy, and I'm buying this stuff from 1995. And where are you shipping it? To Florida. We have a very good customer in Tampa, Florida. I said, darn, my dad's taking me everywhere. So, you know, I was recently in the Azores. My wife says she can't have any time alone. We were in Barcelona, and I was celebrating my 49th wedding anniversary. And I'm up on this island there looking at a Jesuit cathedral. And somebody says, Richard Gonzmart. My wife was where you are, Sandy. Those eyes were piercing right through me. You know, we're all around. I'm nobody, but she's not here with us today, but she's always with me. I met her when she was 13. I was 15. She went to an all-girls school, went to an all-boys school, and I asked her to dance. Everybody said she wouldn't dance. We danced. We didn't talk. Later on, May 28th, she was trying out for cheerleading as a 14-year-old, and one of my bandmates introduced me. She was too young to date. And then she came on June 7th and said, I'm going to come with my grandmother, Alice Lazara. Can you meet me? I put on my three-piece suit. That was from Cuba, that from Spain. And I sat there, table 92. And she sits down, and I'm really shy. And she is. And I've got braces. And I've got a picture from that time. Here comes my daddy. And he says, do you like that girl? Oh, my God. And then he looks at her, did you know Richard's grandfather threw your grandfather out of the Columbia? I said, oh, God. But you won't see me sitting at table 92 or 392 as it's known today. I asked her to marry me 4 years later. I have a picture of that, too. And so we went that first year of marriage in Spain, so my dad wanted me to go, and he gave me an American Express card. Part of your education is go to the best Spanish restaurants. And when I finished, he says, are you done? I said, yeah, I'm done. Okay, then get ready to work hard hours. Oh, my stomach. 3 weeks later, I said, Dad, here's a program where I can go back. He said, no, you blew it.
But I am blessed to have only worked for my father. I'm blessed to have learned at the age of 3 years old, my first job was walking to the coolers where I saw the whole fish and they scared me. And I ran out. My grandpa says, "Que te pasa, muchacho? What's wrong with you?" And he took me back and said, "You look in the eyes for the clarity. The gills should be dark red and moist. And you touch the flesh. And every Friday you come back and tell me." And that was my job. 3 years old. Honest to goodness, I felt like a big boy. Until one day I'm crying. They said, "Ahora que te pasa? Now what's wrong with you?" "I can't tell if the fish are fresh. There's no heads." This is the way my mind works. Well, that kitchen's not there. That door is there still. I left that door. I have to put a sign. Every day I walk by there, I remember what my grandfather taught me. And there were times where the fish we didn't have was fresh. I know my fish. I know my products. I know where everything comes from. I went to St. Augustine, and I was trying my fish, and it was the wrong fish. "This is the wrong fish." "No, it's not." "Yes, it is." Bang, bang, and it's wrong. I fired that company. They didn't give me what they said. They didn't give me the right scallops. I know the fish. We had the other one there. I know where everything comes from. I work with family businesses. That's what made this country great. When we were closed, the Compart family, 5 generations out of Minneapolis, they raised their hogs in Iowa. They called, "Let us know when you're going to open. We're going to start preparing pig for you." We work with Gordon Food Service out of Minneapolis, the 18th largest independent company, family business, as our suppliers. I won't work with large corporations, and anybody that's here, I apologize. But when you put your name on a wine like the Torres family when I was in Spain, and they didn't have a supplier, they're friends of my parents. And after I finished school, I bought 1,200 cases, and I called my dad in all my glory with 2 restaurants. "What did you do?" The Columbia only had 25 wines. They had Lambrusco, Blue Nun, Matus, Pouilly Fossé. They had 5 Spanish wines. That's where the wine list started, where we have over 13 wines at the Ybor. It's a passion. I live life with passion. And if you get an email from me, I said, "Here's your life in embracing each day with gratitude, with passion, with empathy, with kindness and love, faith and purpose." And that's the way we should all live. And I can't wait to start. I woke up at 1:30 last night. And I couldn't wait. I couldn't even think about it because I was excited to come here. I hadn't prepared any thoughts of what I was going to do. I said, "I better start thinking about this." Yeah, you can see my notes. Everything on my notes is not what I said. I appreciate y'all being here with us and with Maruchi, and I appreciate her friendship, what she's doing. And that exhibit upstairs, when I go up there, it takes me back to Cuba. I want to go back to Cuba when it's free.
Do we have any other questions from the audience or any Zoom questions? There we go.
All the men in town, whatever religion they were, that's where they went in the morning for business.
So what they used to have, the coffee pots right there in a dishwasher, and they would make the sandwiches in the window. I can remember that, and there was a little takeout window. So you may not know, and we roasted our coffee from 1926 till my great-uncle's death in 1982. The Naviera family had been roasting coffee in Ybor City since 1921, and they had to move out 3 years ago, and I bought the building from them. And I'm going to put a Sicilian market there. I just closed on the Metropolitan Cigar Store there. I'm going to have Segunda Central Bacon Bed on 7th Avenue, and Danny Fernandez from Naviera is going to roast the coffee. I believe in history. I think what we have to do is have the aroma of coffee, bread, and foods where people can shop. I think that Ybor City once again has to have resonance. I think we need to have ways that people can get to work without having a car.
Yes, Billy, we have a question over here.
Hello, I came up with the question 2 questions ago, and so you have responded a bunch to it already. I heard you, I'm a politician, Kim O'Connor, so I have to say my name one time. That at the Hillsborough County Bar Association, and 2 questions ago, you hadn't spoken, I thought, enough about the way you source your ingredients for your restaurants. Now, since then, you've mentioned the fish, and you've mentioned some other things, but it's so fascinating that the way he goes and visits the farms and everything about all of his procurement and individual connection with suppliers.
Was there a question in that?
If he has more stories on that, I'd like more stories.
Oh. Oh, yeah.
My first you know. Ask, there was no story. There was no stories, but there, I think there are more stories.
You know what I've learned is the stories from the four generations before me. And when we did the book, I was actually writing it, and I had 80 chapters, and I didn't back whatever you do with equipment. I lost everything. I didn't back it up. I didn't save it, yeah. But so I dictated it out, and so I break it down with many of those stories. But I'm working to do something that's really about life and lessons and mistakes, and you learn from mistakes. And if you don't make a mistake, you haven't learned how to succeed. And there's a lot of stories. You know, when business was slow, my grandfather would say he'd start painting the walls to show strength, to give confidence. When we closed for COVID, I was prepared for this challenge because what I faced, we have no debt, basically. We put a new roof on Eulalie. We built a new kitchen over in St. Augustine. We tore out the wall in the Columbia Ebor to build a bigger dishwasher. I invested $1 million in a dishwashing machine, two machines. It's to be safety for the, we have a system that chews up all the product, the shells, and it recycles the water, reduces the waste by 90%, extracts all the water and throws it into the dumpster clean. So it's compost, it'll turn into compost, landfill. I'm working to recycle the glass and oyster shells. I'm looking to build the restaurant. I want to get the oyster shells and my glass and make concrete. We were recognized by this Fair Families of Fine Wine and throughout the country as one of the sustainable companies in the world, first in the United States. I was so honored. And they did an interview in France, and they interviewed me. I'm there talking. We were finalists. We lost out to a family that made uniforms for Napoleon. First prize was 100,000 euros. So we're the oldest restaurant in Florida, but I'm trying to be the most innovative. We have to be responsible. So the new restaurant, we're going to have wind energy. We're going to have solar energy. All my lights will be. We'll be having artificial reefs. We're going to work with USF. I'm going beyond because I just want to be that leader, how we don't continue using the fossil fuels. So it's, I'm a Don Quixote of sorts.
Do you have any trade relationship with Cuba?
Nope, never have. Never have. Won't. So my integrity is the most important thing that I could never let anybody jeopardize. I know everybody I do business. I know those people that do trade in Cuba. I do nothing. I do with Spain and Italy and the United States. So what I can't get from the United States, I want to do business with the United States, manufactured in the United States. I have no problem paying more money. It's better. Years ago, we bought some chairs from China. They lasted a year and a half. Never, ever again. I wish Apple would make the phones in the United States. So, I mean, I won't go to Cuba. While I want to, I have fond memories as a child, and I don't want them to be ruined.
We have a question from Zoom, a few actually.
Yes.
The first is, do you have any opportunities for children to tour your restaurant in Ybor and learn about the history?
We welcome schools all the time. But I love when I see people my age saying that they were there taking a tour. When I see schools, I go to talk to them. I love talking to children. Somebody said I
want to add to it.
Yeah. Somebody said I go revert into it.
So it was probably 2 weeks ago. We had a Girl Scout troop months ago reach out to us. Okay.
So months ago we had a Girl Scout troop, Brownie troop, reach out to us that they wanted to get their badge for Hispanic Heritage Month. And so I had the joy of giving a tour to a bunch of Brownies and Girl Scouts aging in range from 7 to 12 years old. We walked all throughout the restaurant. They asked all sorts of kind of questions. My first one was, how old are you? They're like, you're too old to be graduated from college. I'm like, that was a long time ago. But no, I it is one of my biggest pleasures when I get to give tours to these students and go talk to them. And their questions are always so colorful and fun. And so I like to relieve him. It's not a burden, but he's got so much to do that that is one of my greatest joys, is to give tours to children.
If I see a school bus, I will leave my office. My office is looking at the front door and back door. And we had St. Andrews from Vero Beach the other day, and I love talking to kids and taking them a tour and sharing it. Because aren't those your future customers? Don't you want them to remember? To me, it's so important, that fond memory. I love to see children there. I love, we put children's menus, prices very inexpensive, because you don't want to go somewhere and pay $15 for something they're not going to eat. I want to make the meals. I think our meals for children at dinner are $5.95 or something, $6.95. We had a price increase. But, you know, it's children are so important.
There's a question right here.
Thank you. First of all, Mr. Gonzmart, I want to thank you.
Please call me Rich. That's for my dad.
Thank you for being here and doing this for us. You're truly a legend in our community. So I do have a question. This may be a tough one. You guys have done so much over such a long period of time in our community. But looking back, and let's just start today, because I have a feeling you're not done yet. But looking back up till today, if you had to single out what you're most proud of that you've accomplished, what would it be?
Very difficult question. 1983, I was nominated and appointed by President Reagan to serve on the Selective Service Board. I never served our country, but I'd heard stories of a person here in World War II that if you didn't have money, he'd draft you. And if you did, he wouldn't go. And that just sickened me, that thought that you might send a child. So for 20 years, that's the maximum we could be served. I was the chairman of District 30, the Selective Service Board, because I know when things were bad, we would go through training. That would do what's right. So that's just something that nobody knows, that to me, to be able to serve my country in a way that would be fair. My second thing that was most honored, I'm just a single person. Pope Francis honored me with the highest recognition in the Catholic Church, the Pro Ecclesia. So they made me an honorary Monsignor. And I've got that. So I look at that. I almost became a priest till I met my wife. But you don't do things for rewards, awards. One was that, and I serve on the Florida Highway Patrol Advisory Board. I did it for secretary for the last 25 years. Why? Because in 1979, I got stopped by Trooper Jeffrey Young, driving from Sarasota, racing. He was going the opposite way, and he stopped me. He was really professional. And he stopped me, and I apologized. He gave me a ticket. What impacted me is the following week, he got shot with his own revolver by a drug runner. And his one-year-old daughter ended up becoming a stripper. So for the last 15 years, I've been presenting sponsor for the Police Unity Tour of the Southeast. And I rode 3 days where we ride to the wall where there's over 19,000 men and women died. And when I came in, there was a mother with a big picture of her son. Please never forget my children. I look at those men and women that sacrifice their lives. I'm involved with the Tampa Police. I donate the canines. I built a facility. That's what I'm proud to do. Everything else that matters. How can I make this a safer place for everybody? I don't like guns. That's why I have 2 German Shepherds.
Are there any other questions?
Yes, sir.
We have a couple of questions from Zoom about the dancers at your restaurant. They want to know a little bit about the history and how it still occurs today.
Get ready. They're getting ready to perform.
Ray, did you have a question?
First of all, thank you so much for being with us today.
Yeah.
It's an incredible honor to be with you today.
It's an honor to be here. If you've been into Eulalie,
I have. I've been
here
every single
time. Eulalie, if you go in there, my wife and I bought all that. And my daughter and my wife hung everything.
the horse I found in Peru when I was going from Miami through Central America to South America to see the indigenous food of the people, what they ate. And Victor Delphine, this great artist that did the great, I love auctions, I can win. And that horse in there was made in 1961. So everything reflects some. The restaurant, the grill, I went to a restaurant called the Creux de Cheval in Montreal for German Shepherd Championships of Canada. And it was an old building on the water. The Creux de Cheval, the horse's tail. And when I saw this after it was built, the horse's tail is up in the air. No coincidence, there's a painting there of Eric Rensen called On the Park, kind of a Guernica's, but today, and I bought that 2 years before I had the contract because my wife says, you know you want it. You know you're gonna do it. So if you go into Santo Stefano, you should go with me. I can tell you every piece, what I bought and why I meant it. When I bought this horse 8 years ago, my wife says, what are you gonna do with that? And then she says, now I understand. I think things different. So I might get along great with you, or I could drive you crazy. Because I really know what I want to do, and I want to save and preserve that history of that 1925 building that was going to be destroyed, demolished, my favorite building in Ybor. It didn't matter what it cost. It was to make it what it was and repurpose it back to making pasta. So,
come help me taste food.
Richard, we have a treat tonight for our audience, and it's your dance troupe. You want to introduce Maria so she can come out and tell us a little bit about what they're doing?
Maria, as far as I start, is a young lady. Her mother's from Sevilla. She went to the Academy of the Holy Names, and her sister was under her, and I coached her in track and field. I coached girls track for 4 years.
Maria, where are you? Come on out. There she
Maria,
is.
Maria, I couldn't see her. I'll let Maria tell you about herself. She's a tremendous talent. My mother started the Ballet Folklorico. She was there, and she's carried on my mom's mission.
Thank you, Richard. Thank you, everybody, for having me tonight.
Please tell us what inspired your performance for tonight with the wonderful women you'll be dancing with.
Well, Richard just said it. I mean, when I started at the Columbia back in June 8th, 1988, I just finished my 34th year at the Columbia Restaurant. Next year will be my 35th year, and I've been dance director since November of 2008, and that was such a blessing. I've always wanted to be able to show through dance, and yes, my mother's from Seville, Spain, and flamenco's been my life. I breathe it. It's like eating. It's like nothing for me. I hear a song, I get inspired, and I start creating images, costumes, ideas. Everything just comes into my mind. But when I did start at Columbia, is when I met the fabulous Adela Gonzmart. Of course, Cesar Gonzmart as well are the ones that hired me. It's a beautiful time in my life. I thought, this would be great. Going to college, do this for a few years, and here I am. I went to the Academy of Holy Names. I'm class of 87, very proud of it. And my sister's class of 93. I've been on the alumni board now for 8 years. I'm very proud of the Academy of Holy Names and the education that my parents were able to provide for me. But I did. I got one point. I said, Dad, I can't focus anymore. I wanted to be a psychology major. I just want to dance. And he's like, okay. But don't think just because you got hired at the Columbia that you've arrived. You know, I expect you to go to workshops every year. You go to Spain, you go to New York, you go to Miami. And I did, and I've dedicated my life, and I try to be the best. And I want always to represent not just about my culture, but also represent the best for the Columbia Restaurant and also this beautiful city of Tampa. And that's when I became director in 2008 that I said, I'm going to call it the Tampa Bay Flamenco Dance Company. It's not going to be Maria Sparza Dance Company. Yeah, people know me, but still, it's going to be the Tampa Bay Flamenco Dance Company. So anytime anybody like Googles and wants a flamenco show, they're going to hit Tampa, they're going to hit flamenco, and I want it to be the Bay to represent everything. But that's where I've come, and not to get too sidetracked, but I can hear and talk all night about dance and about flamenco, but starting at the Columbia, is when I met Adela Gonzmart. And she had this vision that she wanted to have this ballet folklorico of Ybor, and she wanted to do dances that represented all the heritage that came and brought Ybor together from Spain, from Cuba, and from Italy. And that's how it all started. So that really, you know, influenced me a lot. And I wasn't born in Tampa, but I've been here since I was 5 years old. And, you know, Cuban is just part of our culture and who we are, and it's like it's everywhere. So, and I love dance. Now, of course, flamenco is my heart, but I love all dance, and I love salsa, and I love, you know, merengues and bachatas and all that. And so when Richard came to me with this idea, he was like, we're going to do this event here tonight. It would be great if you guys could, like, perform. I was like, I'm on it. I'm on it. We've got to find the right song. So I just started researching, and it's like one of those things that you just know when you just fall in love for the first time. I like, this is the song. This is my song, and we're going to wear royal blue because we're going to represent those beautiful colors that not only our flag has, but the Cuba has. Because red, everyone thinks, okay, Spain and flamenco, but we're going to do royal blue. And this is what we're going to wear. When I designed it from head to toe, and I choreographed it, and my girls have been so dedicated, and we've been doing this for past few months, and we are so excited. Cannot wait for you guys to see our beautiful number. So, yes, thank you so much.
Thank you, Maria.
Thank you, Richard.
And what we're going to do is move out of the way so they can clear the space so we can see Maria's fabulous dancers.
Thank you so
and
much.
We'll see you in a little bit.
Ahora, como la primera vez. Bye, my friend.
Columbia restaurant dancers talking about Celia Cruz, another Cuban fantastic artist. Richard, thank you so much. Andrea, thank you for making our conversation such a special and unforgettable one. Thank you to the audience for joining us tonight. Thank you to the audience on Zoom. If you haven't been to see Cuban Pathway, there's no excuse anymore. You've been here for conversations, and when you go to Cuban Pathways, it will be so rewarding. We welcome you to visit us at Cuban Pathways. Thank you for coming tonight. CJ, thank you for your support. Have a wonderful evening. Buenas noches, damas y caballeros. Thank you.